cooking is a very good word for a lot of things that we want to say. I want to say, like, what we're cooking, like, especially in our system now, this word actually have a huge, we have a cooking stage, just imagine.
Oh, okay.
In the game, okay. Cooking stage.
So that's like a default, or what was
like,
that amount to?
Guys, like, it's cooking stage, what the fuck are you doing? Like, something, you know? Is this protocols are different in cooking stage.
Damn, okay. All right.
This is good.
Are you tired of your boring old skins? Head to Trade It and trade them for exciting new ones within seconds. With 24/7 support, massive inventory, free giveaways, and low fees, Trade It is the highest rated trading platform in the market. What are you waiting for? Start trading today for a $5 bonus, only on Trade It.
Bet.
Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, Counter-Strike fans around the globe, welcome back to another installment of HLTV Confirmed. Shout out to the sponsors of the show who keep the lights on the wheels spinning. 1xBet, remember to gamble responsibly, and trade it.gg. Instant secure CS2 skin trading. Check them out if you're in the market for skins. All right, on tonight's episode, we'll be diving into all things post-Chengdu, the recent roster revelations, and we've got a spicy hot seat for everybody. Lucas is in the international HLTV space station producing the show as per the use. We've got him up there. He's, you know, so far he's in outer orbit at the moment. My right and left hand men's and Prof and Striker are joining us for the expedition as well. We won't be going out of the space. We'll be staying here on Earth, and we won't keep the man waiting. This evening we are in elite company, ex-professional turned coach, only one of three, someone fact check me, coaches of all time to be a multi-major winner. Best Instagram in all of esports, the big brain at NAVI, Blade. Thank you for joining us this evening. Just over 2 weeks, mate, since the major win. How you been celebrating?
Amazing. It's not like I was celebrating, but the feeling is amazing. It's I think it's a huge achievement for me and for the lineup. And for players also, they don't have a lot of experience, right? And they don't have a lot of trophies. And imagine some of them have just first trophy win. It's like major.
Kind of crazy. Amazing. Yeah, Prof was saying he thought you were off on some like island, you know, celebrating out there in the Bahamas, you're sipping some cocktails, thinking of all the next things you're going to do with the team, but you're just at home.
No, we're actually practicing for Malta already. We had like 8 or 7 days of break, and now it's time to practice.
Okay. I guess everybody like Emma and the likes of JL, it took them a while to get through the airport because of all the fans. So, you know, it took them an extra few days to get home or something along those lines. That was pretty cool footage to see. You know, seeing them have all the people standing at the airports for them in their home countries. That was really cool. But look, let's do this. We got to roll the bumper so we can officially start the hot seat, and then we'll get into the real questions. Let's do it, Lucas. Damn, that chair is bloody hot. The fact we don't have a chair sponsor is crazy, isn't it? All right, we'll work on that in the future. Maybe there'll be something coming. Look, we're going to get into all the juicy business. Blade, you did an interview not that long ago. I think it was on the 12th of April with players.com.ua, if I'm reading that correctly. And there was a fair few threads on HLTV or Reddit that popped up from that. And then that kind of is going to help us tonight with some of our questioning. I know Prof and Striker dug into that one, gave it a bit of a read. But gentlemen, where do we want to start with the questioning for Blade to this evening?
I think just from the win, we kind of touched on it a bit, but I think just expanding on it, I think you, Chad, said in the intro, like the three two-time major winners as champions. That's Zonic, Zeus with Brazilians back-to-back, and now Blade. And Blade, you're the only guy that did it with like completely different rosters, right? And also one international, one like domestic lineup. So very, very different circumstances. So let's just start there. And how does it feel for you in terms of like a coaching achievement to go on this level?
It feels amazing, trust me, because from the beginning it was a huge challenge for me when we changed the lineup and went international. And in some interviews I said like it's a huge challenge for me because I never experienced anything like that. And also background, I think, of let's say CIS players is a little bit different. And it was very interesting to start, at least. And imagine like from that period, like it's like less a year passed and we already won major. And it's a huge thing, at least to realize. And a lot of details in my head, like in terms of like the system we tried to build, how we changed the system, like from previous lineup, our like CS21 lineup, how everything improving, like, and from expectations to reality, like I think I didn't expect to win major like so fast. Yes, we had a goal, like for sure. In the beginning, in January on bootcamp, we even had a goal. Like I said, guys, let's build something. So we like in these 3 months, so we at least come to major with the feelings that we can win. So we have a chance to win. This was for me like the main goal, like to come to major, to have this, to build something that like you can operate, you know, around the map with players, and to be ready to win. And yes, we work really hard for that. Like last bootcamp before major was really tough.
We mentioned out the gate there the fact that the other team was more of a domestic team and this new one's an international team. Do you notice a big difference in the way that the teams are able to communicate with each other? I don't mean in the server. I mean the way that you guys would talk theory or get through difficult times.
Well, I don't think so.
Okay.
But yeah, mentality is different. That's for sure. The whole like character of players is different. The background, cultural background is different. That's for sure. And that was a huge challenge also.
Okay.
I think that you need, but it's good. Like you're just analyzing what is going on and you just try to build with this material. Like you understand like, okay, we have these issues, we have these weaknesses, we have the strengths. How we can balance everything, how we can optimize. This is an interesting process from the beginning.
All right. Do you want to, Prof?
Yeah, I want to jump something in because I think we're kind of touching on kind of the creation of this roster, so might as well go in that direction. But
Sure. Just
kind of looking back at some of the things that you said, like in this recent interview and just in general, is like, you know, kind of the limitations of some of the players, not maybe the limitations, but like, let's say JL and Ime coming into the lineup were pretty inexperienced. They had a good major, you know, Aleksib had some great results, but also had a lot of doubts around him. You know, he was obviously like in and out of a few rosters. You know, if you get kicked out of NIP, that's always kind of like, okay, what's going on here? So when you made the international team, was your perception of this kind of like, I don't know if you saw the movie Moneyball, but it's like you're kind of picking up some pieces that are almost left over. You're not building, you know, a great lineup. You're not getting like everything perfect that you want, but it's more like you're having some risky pieces that you really need to work on. And that's why kind of the win came as a surprise too.
You know, speaking about the win as a surprise, it's something we can touch maybe also. It's an interesting topic. But overall, speaking about the lineup, yes, I think that's not a surprise for anyone, but the lineup we had before international was kind of like a lineup of star players. And we had one of the best duos in CSGO. And the lineup we built, like, it was potentially like lineup which could build like some era, you know, eventually. And this for sure. We wanted to change, when we decided to change to international, we wanted to have really strong lineup from the beginning, because it's NAVI, and NAVI is kind of really high status organization, and we always were driving and hunting trophies. This is very important for us, and this is the fact. You cannot get all players that you want. This is fact. And we took all we analyzed market, and we took the best that we saw on that moment in terms of building something, so piece by piece, in terms of having one strong unit, balanced unit, something like this. It wasn't like we took everyone we could take. I mean, like, imagine like the market is fully free, like you can pick like one from Vitality, one from this. This is different, right? So we couldn't like build the strongest lineup in history, that's for sure. And we just built the strongest from our point of view lineup from players that were available on the market. That's exactly like you said. And the main goal was to go international, to start from something. And this was the main thing. Like, we just needed to start with something. And yeah, it worked eventually. I think the whole idea was, we start, we see how it goes, obviously, like any lineup. We trying to fix mistakes, we're trying to build like the system, then we see how the flows are like pop here and there, and then we try to fix them, and then we try to maybe to change something, maybe then we try to change a player. Obviously, it can be in our mind, because we are building something new, something we even don't know what will be, because it's a new thing for us, also international roster. So a lot of thoughts were in our mind, but the way how it ended eventually, I mean, the win of Major is, that's why I always say this, this is crazy in terms of result. It's not, I can say it's not something like we were not expecting at all, like it's a surprise win, like you said. We have a mentality and we were trying to build like this, and we know that it is like this, that you can win any team at specific moment. This is Counter-Strike and this is MR12 nowadays. So we were super realistic in terms of, if we do everything correct, if we try to use every factor that matters, like starting from vetoes, ending with game plan, we can win any team. There's at least, there's always a chance to do this. And our win versus FaZe is a huge example. Well, this is a fact, actually.
You touched on an interesting topic there, and I wanted to ask about it a little bit later, but we can get into it now. You were talking about how, you know, you were like, one of the options would have been to consider replacing players, you know? So, and I'm curious about what your philosophy is about that in general, because historically I feel NAVI have been quite patient before, you know, going into that direction, at least, you know, before you went international. So do you feel like that philosophy changed a little bit when you went international, just because of how unpredictable maybe you expected it to be? You know, you didn't know what to expect from the international roster. Did you think that, you know, down the line, in a year from then, you know, you would still keep at least most of the roster, or at least the roster that you put together, or the trio that you put together with the move to international lineup?
I think it's not a secret, and everyone understands this. So it will not be like, this will not be a surprise if I say that big organization like NAVI and others will always have a change if they don't succeed. This is obvious. So it's something that always thumbs somewhere in the air. Everyone knows about this. So if you don't achieve like in 1 year something, you need a change. And we can see the results from other teams, for example, like Astralis, right? They built something and now they have a change. We don't know what we'll expect from Liquid also, if this lineup will not succeed eventually, right? Maybe in like how many, 2-3 events left before, I mean, summer season, we don't know what they're cooking, right? And the same for other lineup. Maybe Vitality, if they will not win anything this before the summer, maybe they will also have it as a change. So yeah, we were planning like this. So we are trying to build something, to build a core, and to be like there is also some, let's say, justice, because we give a chance still to everyone. It's not like we are using somebody. There is a chance, like decent chance of period of time where any player can have time and space to evolve and to progress. So I think for me it's like more like a natural process. This is how it must be, and it's not. I think for me it's not a secret. I think it's not a secret for everyone, right? It works like this on Tier 1 organizations.
Yeah, but they also speak about like a year, you know, down the line. Like if we don't have results for a year, usually teams don't really wait for a year. They will jump at opportunities much faster than that. And I feel like maybe from your perspective, I don't know if you agree with this, you are more patient than other organizations, typically at least.
Yeah, it's all about what is the team is cooking at this moment, because we can see only the results, maybe some interviews, like if you analyze other teams, but the whole process, what is happening behind the curtains, is the main thing. And if they see the dynamic, if the team see that, obviously they see more than others, so then obviously they have more time. So who knows, maybe in 1 year they will remove me if you don't succeed, right? So it's all about the result. It's true.
I think this, I don't know where my question is here. I'm sure there might be one, but Navi for me always seems like the org which is still, it's got everybody behind the curtain that the people don't see, but they're all Counter-Strike people. Like that's what it feels
that's
like.
True. That's
to me.
True. Yes. All top management is old CS 1.6.
Yeah. So that would explain why they have a better grasp on the way things work than some of these other organizations. Actually, even some of these other organizations who got old 1.6 people who were removed for a very long time, they didn't really stick the landing. I'm sure the people at home know who we're talking about, but I think that's probably a reason as well behind like Navi's success for sure. Do we want to continue?
Chad, you're always so happy when you can like shit on orgs not from Counter-Strike, and especially in a, like American orgs in a backhand way. I feel like
it's fun.
I mean, we'll talk about Cloud9 a bit later, so
do we want to ask more questions about the international side of things, guys? Because I wanted to bring up a tweet.
Yeah, you can do it. Yeah.
Okay, Lucas, bring this tweet up, and I'll read it. And I'm sure Blade knows it very well. This is what you tweeted after the major win, Blade. You said, "Major review. Being underdog is a huge privilege, and it wasn't wasted." Do you want to expand on that for the viewers at home?
I think this is a huge privilege. This is a huge privilege. We felt kind of zero pressure in terms of, like, I know what is the pressure because we were like positioned on Navi, like for example in Stockholm Major, and we were huge favorites, and there was huge pressure. So I think we abused a lot the moment when we started to play City Side Inferno. And we kind of, it was, the feeling was there that they are not playing how they maybe want to play, you know, kind of a lot of hesitation, a lot of maybe not calculated moves. And you can abuse this a lot on City Side if you have a system, and if you kind of communicate properly, like on timeouts, on freeze time, you know the weaknesses of this situation. And we knew how it was. So, in Navi before. So the way how we started to play, and Valeri like beat, he was feeling this. You saw this, like how he was dictating the pace, basically, a lot of times on City Side. And that's why it's a privilege, I think. Because you can, not taming opponent, but it's kind of you are using a huge gap, right? In maybe a mental aspect, I don't know how to explain it in English, but yeah, I think it's very important in grand finals of big events. It's different Counter-Strike. We must understand this, and if in future you will see some crazy results, don't be surprised. I mean, if some of the team will win in grand final of big event, especially major, this is just different Counter-Strike. There is like every decision is about like the bold moves is crucial, you know, and if you feel the pressure and you don't know how to handle this, to handle the situation on the map, if you don't have the answer, or if you imagine you have an answer and then you fail with this answer, how much pressure you will have. Also, it's about expectations. I don't know what expectations was for FaZe, but most likely they were expecting to win a lot, right? And this is the most dangerous thing when you're starting to lose. When I think every Tier 1 player knows this feeling, when you're starting to lose, where you expected to win huge in a huge scale.
Do you think they underestimated you?
I think in a little, let's say, for sure there was a little bit underestimation. Okay. Maybe overthinking, maybe underestimation. We actually, it will be really interesting to know the answers from FaZe for some interview, like from their point of view, why they lost, like real answer why they lost. I think it's very valuable information for a lot of coaches, a lot of organizations, players. It's very interesting, and I mean their point of view and. Mentioned peak, for example. Was it overthinking or was it something else? We need to know that, like, the real answer.
I wanted to ask about watching NAVI throughout the whole major. Obviously, we were looking at the EMA, he was obviously underperforming. We were looking at that bit wasn't there as well, you know, to maybe pick up the slack, and at least not to the level that we know that he can, you know, all the way up until the grand final. I think we didn't see the real bit throughout the whole major, you know. So with this in mind, you know, with seeing that maybe two of your players that are pretty key to the system aren't performing to the same level, were you surprised to keep going as far as you did, you know, that your individuals maybe weren't in the best form?
We had ups and downs, let's say like this. We had ups and downs. We had a good preparation on bootcamp. We seeded a lot of important things in our system and overall, like in a strat book and map pool. Especially we were cooking like a lot ancient, you know, which is, I think, a lot of teams didn't realize. For example, for like sure. when we are like losing. I mean, Ancient was the main map we were preparing on bootcamp. We were playing it, like, twice more than other maps. I think so. Maybe,
Is that because it was a weakness? Because I remember watching you guys at the start of the year, and you guys weren't getting, like, the double mid-mollies down. I remember, I think it was Katowice.
I think Util is completely different aspect. Like, I think we can separate the weakness of the map with Util, because this is, like, two different things. Just people maybe didn't prep, because I mean you can have a really good interesting stuff like protocols everywhere, all the stuff, reactions, but still like missing Util, right? It's like a little part of a bigger picture, but still for example, losing to why we were prepping, because this was our weak map. Yes, it's true overall, and it wasn't something like we were cooking a lot, something special. It was more like we were trying to shape up our map pool. We need, like, if you analyze like matchups and you see like what maps can be, you can count like versus top 10 teams, for example, that you will need this map, and then you start to prep. This is normal kind of analysis to prep for tournament. And at that moment, Ancient was this map that we will need if we know the meta of picking and all this stuff. And we lost, for example, to Spirit and Cloud9 on this event. And I think Spirit and Cloud9, teams that were like picking this map a lot because they're really good on that map. And we know Spirit, we know Cloud9, how they play. And the scores was not so bad. It was like maybe 13-9 or something for us. I mean 9 for us. So imagine like the statistics were showing like this is our worst map before playoff. But this is how statistics will kind of fool you at some point. You know, you need to go deeper in statistics, because after we are losing to such teams as Cloud9 and Spirit, you can have a lot of analysis and you have time before playoff to see what was wrong, right? So I think Ancient was the huge part of us winning the major, because it helped us versus G2 and it helped us versus FaZe, for sure.
Yeah, okay, this puts us in a good position. So let me just quickly, for the listeners, recap your run at the major. You guys played Mongols and then G2 in the best of ones. Both of those were wins. Then you played Spirit and Cloud9 in the best of threes. You needed to get past Pain. Then after Pain, you go to the playoffs. You play Eternal Fire. That's a 2-0. You play G2, 2-1. And then you play FaZe 2-1 to win the whole thing. Now, the G2 one, did you see all of the all the conversation online regarding the veto for G2?
I wasn't at veto.
No. Okay. So there was a lot of
I remember. I know what the thing about Taz and Hooksy and Inferno and Ancient.
Yes.
It was everything correct. Like G2, what they're saying, this is everything correct. I think Taz, and he said that it was his mistake, and he was insisting on Ancient, and Hooksy wanted to play Inferno. And from what I felt,
I guess hindsight being 2020, they probably should have gone with Inferno, because that was the third and deciding map of the series. But then Inferno also against FaZe, you fucked them.
Yeah, but also it's also about prep, you know. I think if Taz brought it, maybe they for sure had a conversation about this, right? If he said we need to play Ancient instead of Inferno, so it was something they were talking about before. It's not some random stuff and like they meet first time in the day, right?
Sure.
And start to say about this. So,
I mean, if they do, then they deserve to lose.
Yeah.
And the thing is that we also won them, I think, one or two times before on Inferno. So they also pick a lot of Inferno. Sometimes you don't want to pick them up that people expect, but on the tier one level, it's not so comfortable and people have huge prep for you on number 12. And but still, yeah, on this kind of tournaments, I think you need a confidence map for sure. So they were a little bit, let's say, delusional about our Ancient, that's for sure.
Sure. Well, there was also the Aleksib factor, right? About Aleksib going up against G2 and always beating them. So I'm sure that was in their head as well. It felt like even though on paper they were seen as like the better team, you guys had the edge in a lot of different areas. Like that mental edge is something that I'm sure plagues G2 every day of the week, thinking, oh, fuck, we can't beat Aleksib.
Yeah, if you're on social media, that's for sure.
Okay. That's for sure. Get off social media. Is that the advice?
If it affects you, if you scanning yourself and you feel like you for sure need to scan yourself on this aspect, like, yes, mental aspect is very important. If you're not working on this aspect, it means that you are not ready for tier one, that's for sure. But we don't know about this, how this affect them. But yeah, it's not good if you are thinking about, if your head is full of some different thoughts that are not even connected to the game.
I wanted to add, like, because we talked about a bunch of things, but so far you mentioned kind of two key things in Navi's major victory. And I think since it wasn't like a massive underdog, but also kind of an underdog victory. And it's going to be like one that people are going to talk about. And like 5-10 years from now, people will be like, oh, but that Navi run, how did that happen? Some people say it's a fluke, whatever. So far you said like, key thing was in the final, not having pressure, like being not under the pressure, not being the favorite, right? You said the Ancient, your Ancient kind
Vito,
of being,
overall. I think Vito versus semifinal and final affected a lot.
Yeah.
As a result.
Is there one more thing, if you can find, that you would say that that really was crucial in Navi winning this major that made the difference?
Another thing, like third
yeah.
one, I think, I think JL for sure surprised me a lot. is like there's a lot of like every one of our players did a really good job. That's for sure. Like I'm like proud of each of them. But the most who surprised me was Justinas, and because he was kind of making a lot of mistakes on bootcamp in terms of decision making, like analyzing macro and so on. And obviously understand that he is the less experienced player out, I think, of every other, right, in our team. That he is learning constantly. But still, the way how he has this mentality, like this fire inside of him, you know, like kind of always fired up, basically. His mindset is very good for Tier 1 competition. Very good.
I noticed. Sorry to interrupt you.
No, it's good.
I was just going to say, after he had the round on Ancient with the Deagle against G2, like I was like looking at the face cam, and it like he got fired up with that round, like he was fucking pumped. But he like took a breath and then centered himself immediately and was like, "Well, job's not fucking done." Like I was like, "Holy shit!" Like you don't normally see that. Normally they just go off their tree and then. But he actually like took a moment to compose himself. And before you guys started the final. Maybe it was the semifinal. I'm not sure. No, it was the semifinal. I was just kind of like looking at him, and he was getting ready, and he's just looking out at the crowd. I was like, what is he thinking about, mate? I don't know what's going on in his head, but he was just taking it all in. So it was crazy to see that type of performance from him in those impact games. And he seems like such a nice guy.
Yes, he's a very nice guy. Sometimes, not just before the major, for example, some events, he maybe interact too much with the camera, you know?
Okay, yeah.
It's like, for me, it'll be hard to focus on the game. It's like, yeah, 50%, like always, each frag, you like, okay, I made an entry. Oh, hello, guys, it's me. You know? So that's kind of interesting, but I think he did it less. On major for sure, like when you watch the what you can see, like he is more, like I said, composed. That's true. Like he was a lot of on the stage, he was fully focused, and we work a lot on this aspect, and I think it's crucial, like I said before, the mental workout, like that exists.
Was there something specific that you did about that, or just, you know, it was how he turned up to the major?
So we, with our performance coach, we are dealing enough time on bootcamp to this aspect, let's say. And I don't believe, like, for example, that you can say some guys, you need to do this, you need to do this, you need to believe, and people just believe. Mm-hmm. You need to cook yourself, basically, how we called it. And we were trying to always do, guys, let's cook ourselves on bootcamp. Like, we need to do everything on bootcamp, because you cannot change your mindset like in these 2-3 days before the match. You need constantly prepare yourself for going like not prime, but peak at right moment, right? And this was constantly every day we were having this conversation. We were starting like bootcamp with like a walk, with a talk, with a mental, let's say, calibration or something, like when we are trying to get this skill inside our system, that people will scan themselves. I don't know on which level it is. It's how you can, for example, now to measure this. I don't know how, right? It's only about people really feeling the difference. And it's kind of we are trying to do as much as possible, because if we will not, you know what I mean, like, right? So better to do something with this, and maybe then it will help, than not to do at all. That's my point. And yeah, it's good thing, I think.
How different... Sorry, Striker, go for it, man.
Yeah, is this new to you? I mean, I know that this is not the first time that you had like a psychologist or a performance coach, but you recently changed them. So I'm curious about if the process is different, if this was like a new thing to you. You're talking about a walk, you know, that's something that teams do a lot these days. You know, they just go on a walk and talk about their problems. So, you know, as they go. So I'm curious about like how this is for you, if this is new experience.
No, we had a walk even before Stockholm Major. We had the same bootcamp with a different performance coach. And she did a really great job, and she's still in NAVI, but she's dealing with other like lineups, like NAVI use, I think, and some others. And the thing is that the walk is more like part of this is a ritual, part of this is like getting oxygen in your blood and in your brain. Part of this is like just overall like moving, not sitting constantly, and all in complex, it's a good thing. And I think if you do it on a permanent basis, correct? Permanent.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. On a permanent basis, this is that can have effect on in dynamic and distance. Okay. It's not something you can do like on Saturday I will do and on Monday I will not. You must do it constantly. This is the thing. And in my opinion, it's like 3% you add to your performance here. 5% you can add somewhere else, and you just rank each factor to push them as fast as much as possible, I think. And I honestly think that performance coach is very important nowadays, because first of all, I as a coach can share my like duties. Okay, for example, if we say it correct, like delegate, right?
Yep.
I can delegate part of important stuff, and for example, while I'm preparing for the game plan for the match day, it's like two last hours before the match. It's very crucial for me to focus like on the game plan, like on pistols, anti-forces, like how we should start, like a lot of details. And it's important that we have somebody with the team who is cooking them, let's say like this. Right,
getting them mentally ready, getting them in the right mind space and everything. Yeah,
and this is what I think Vitality were doing, Astralis were doing, Heroic, like playing with the ball. It's important, like, and it's important to have people who know their job, and they know how it works usually. Like, it's not like some amateur job, right?
Yeah.
And they know algorithms how to change stuff.
I mean, this thing that Chad mentioned actually. Like JL looking into the crowd. Actually, when I rewatched the NAVI vlog from the major, and this is actually something that Ula, like their psychologist, mentioned, like in their pre-game talk before the playoffs. This is like something she told them to do. Mm. Like, instead of like, you know, being afraid of the crowd and blah, blah, you know, before the game, just go out there, just like stare, take it in, and then you go and play your game. So it's kind of tied in together.
He took the advice.
Yeah. Yeah. But it's kind of funny that you brought it up, right?
Well, yeah, we did it.
Looked good. Well, I you want to take in the moment as well, right? You know, you got to think how many times these players are going to be in situations like that. You want to take them in.
I think it depends on players a lot, right? Because I didn't think s1mple need to go on the playoff day number one to feel the atmosphere so he will not be stressed or nervous next one. But yeah, for some players, I think it's important, especially if you didn't easy stage or you haven't been before on such a big stage. It's good at least to see what it is. So it doesn't mean if you're conscious about this. Maybe it's subconscious stuff, you know. Maybe you're just ready. Oh, I saw this yesterday. Because when you go out first time, and you see the crowd from the stage view, it can be for very some people are emotional, some people are impressed, you know, people who are impressed by things. It's all about your character. It's all about how your brain works. So there are some people who can be surprised, like for Rainbow, like, so wow, well, you know, like, this is actually true. This people feel the ball differently, and this is true, and that's for sure. For some people, if they need to go and to feel this, it will help you. Because in my opinion, but maybe there are some other opinions, but in my opinion, you need to block the stage from yourself, like, completely, so you can be cold-blooded playing in the game. But maybe there are some point of view where people can want to feel the stage. I want to feel this energy. I want to interact with the crowd and this flame, like, everything, and this helps me to play. Maybe it's very interesting, like, point of views, you know.
Mm. You not think, you know, when you're talking about it, I feel like Simple is actually one of those people who maybe gets more fired up when they're on the stage. You know, he also was consistently performing better on stages and stuff like that in his prime years, you know. So did you not see that in him, for example?
I think yes. I think Boomich was like this, Simple for sure like this. I think electroNic is more like, not, well, let's say, chilled in a good way, you know, like, he's like basically chilling, like, and it doesn't matter for him, it's stage or not. From what I saw, like, from what I felt, like, he's not feeling the pressure at all when he's playing on stage. Like, for him, it's like the same studio on stage. And he was even more, more like, determined of what he wants to do sometimes.
Mm.
Okay. More, even more. And for me, for example, I know, like, it's still like you're not playing, but I don't feel the, when we are in the game already, I don't feel the stage at all, because there is a constant thinking process of what happened in the round. It just, you don't have time for this.
And that's even for you, because, I mean, for players, I remember the thing about when you guys won the Stockholm Major, people are talking about how Bid has his monitor so close that he can't even see, you know, the people behind. But for you, you obviously can see the people all the time, you know, so it doesn't affect you at all?
In the when the flames bomb is exploding and there is a little flame, I think this is for sure you feel in your world. The hell is this?
Literal heat.
You can feel it across the stage, by the way. I don't know if you've had that experience, but you can be all the way on the other side of the stage and you can feel that.
Yes, and this time it was really hot, actually. And sometimes I was trying to, like, to see, and then I understand that I distract myself and I need to come back, because you see, if you see it properly, like, we prep for the map, we have a lot of details about the opponent, we know how they operate on the map, and we know at what point we want to break them, at what stage of the round, and if you miss like 10 seconds of the round of communication, you can maybe not understand what happened in the round, the thing.
Mm. Well, not to get distracted, that's important.
I want us to pivot here. I wanted to go into Aleksib, if we could, because...
Good
pivot?
Good idea. Yes.
All right.
So I want to talk about the email later as well, but
we'll
a good starting point.
We'll get there too.
This is great.
So are we losing Blade? Is he coming back?
He's turning on lights.
Okay. The sun's gone down. So the interview you did with players.com.ua, and there was a comment in there regarding Aleksib and him when he came to the team, you know, having an old school approach and not being tier one in-game leader and stuff. That's definitely got the interwebs, you know, fire on all cylinders. A lot of people making threads are talking about that, having conversations about that. So I read the interview with it, so I kind of understand where you were going with the angle you... So I guess tell me if this is wrong, but the way that he was playing was still a bit more, they scripted, or they had to run, if they wanted to make a play, they had to run it by Aleksib to get the okay, right? He was kind of puppet mastering every step of the way, whereas what I was reading between the lines with you saying that players need to be able to make the decisions on their own. So we're talking like the modern Counter-Strike of the decision trees, right? So you're in, you play this round, or this happens, this is the reaction, or they have a bunch of reactions that they can make. Is that in the
okay,
right direction?
The idea was that it was fully connected to the answer that about the potential. I think that's why I brought it up, because to see the potential, you need to see how we started, you know? And I think when we started, we could see the raw like player from with their own background from completely different background from our background. So it like means like Mihai, Ime, like JL and Aleksib, and eventually even Wonderful. So it's like only bit left, like four players with different background, you know, and each of them was not kind of like tier one, but tier one is subjective. It's like it's basically like very subjective list of your own list of players, or like not players, but even like characteristics, right?
Sure. But for you, is tier one just like, you know, people that can consistently win titles, or is that how you would describe tier one, or what was your kind
of definition? It was fully abstractive, but they I don't have like, you know, like specific like terminology, like if you tier one, if you do this, it's more like you feel or you know it. But if you speak about it now, for tier one team, I think it's important that you are constantly like in maybe top four, top five on a lot of events, right? Also the way how you play. If you speak about players, this terminology people use nowadays specifically for players who are like very like star players, you know, like let's say like Nico, Robs, like Twist, like phases full of star players. And all these players, I think, is tier one. But how objective is this? If one player get in top 20 HLTV, is he automatically tier one forever or no? I don't know, right? Mm. So it's more about your background, your trophies, like how much you want, basically. How you play. Is Donk is tier one now? Mechanically speaking, yes. But it's all, everything is subjective on this aspect, if you say. That's why I brought it like the topic, because to see that it was the lineup that was completely different from the lineup we had before. The level was bam, going down instantly. I felt it instantly. Not because even like in terms of experience, but also in terms of knowledge. And people also, the way what they learned was different. And now you're speaking about Aleksib, was your question, right?
Yes.
About micromanagement. I think this is a habit, and it is basically natural habit for any AGL. He wants to have everything under control. And this is, when you do this, you want to win, you want to help. It's not something like, no, I will not let you win, you will do like this. It's not like this. It's basically just something how he cooked himself, how he built himself, the way how he were in fundamentally like building step by step, brick by brick. And we must also take into consideration there is no academies or some like school where you can learn Counter-Strike. So he was building his own kind of Counter-Strike vision
from his experiences.
Yes. And when you then nowadays, if you take players from one team to another one, This is a disaster. Like, how do you know what is the background of knowledge of this for this player, right? Mm. He's out of your system, and I felt this already a lot of times. So this is clear. If anyone will take, like, from Vitality, will take some player from, for example, I don't know,
Endpoint,
from Mouse Sports, Endpoint, Mouse Sports, anywhere. Like, I'm pretty sure they will be really surprised with some reactions he has in the game, because this is how he was building with his coach and so on. And this is crucial aspect for sure for building any roster nowadays. That's why we need like academies and so on. And when you don't know, like you have only your Counter-Strike, you don't have because basically you have only this vision because you don't have any other. Nobody was giving you, because he was constantly, Aleksib was constantly building lineups how he was seeing everything, right? From lineup to lineup. And like I said in interview, yes, it was more like positive automatic reaction of trying to, oh, no, don't do this. Or let's do this. Or you do this. Like, can you do this? No, you don't know. Like something like this, you know, you're always constantly trying to control the things. And when we played in Navi in his previous lineup, it was completely different. Our system was completely different. That's why we started this project from the beginning. Like, let's build this lineup with our previous Navi system, which was improved eventually for, because you're constantly improving with everything, right? Evolving. And that's why, how stupid it will be for me, for example, Aleksib, we just do whatever you say and let's see what happens. It will be weird for me because we had experience already with previous lineup. We succeeded. We know how to win. We know it works. And that's why the only way for us was we are building only like this new lineup. We can, because you either have one vision or you have, like I said before, four players from different backgrounds. It can be a disaster. When I see people coming like from three, for example, for me, G2 project with Extas, Aleksib, Nico was kind of weird from the beginning, you know? Because I was building lineups from by myself when I was a player and when I was a coach. And I know the process. This is hard. This is really hard. We have one player, one guy who is in control. That's for sure. Otherwise, there will be always a problem at some point. And he will be in charge. This guy will be in charge. If you won't fire him, but he must be in charge. You know,
I love this so much. This is why I blame you. Are one of the, if not the GOAT coach, but just this, we see this in so like FURIA, we can talk about them later, but I think this is the same shit that happened to them with, they bring in Fallen with Art and Gary in the same team. This doesn't make sense. It's like too many cooks. So you can't cook like three different dishes at the same time. And, it doesn't make sense.
At the same time, they are both cooking, but they are not from the same background. Can be, yeah. Right? Also, it's important.
One guy's making from some Chinese and this guy is making, I don't know, carbonara, and everything gets fucked. Like, it doesn't, yeah, it's bad.
And that's why we, from the beginning, we started. Also, it was important that I know that you cannot change the players at, if they're, for example, not young. If they're 16, 15, 17, and they didn't have a lot of teams, you still can change a lot. When you have Aleksib, who was playing like four or five teams, I know it's hard. Can be to change, so that's why I was mostly like watching first, analyzing. Then we were adding step by step a lot of aspects from our system. So we see how it works here, how it works there, like how it goes in dynamic, you know. And I think we're still in this process. We're still going somewhere. It's not finished at all. Yeah. And also the moment that you are kind of about micromanagement, I think it's a really good thing if you see a problem in the game.
Sure.
Right? So if you see nothing, like we need your help, right? Basically, if players are very passive, if players are not picking and not finding gaps on the map,
find the solution.
Yes. Then this is where you must activate yourself as an IGL and take everything under control. This is for me a perfect IGL, you know? And this is what I would like always Aleksib to be.
Mm. Yeah. If I can just do one thing and then let you go, because like I had a question in mind that I wanted to ask you about this whole, like Aleksib is micromanaging, but we want to change like how he's developing. But then the question is like, how much can you change a player's, you know, approach before he loses his own identity and, you know, it can't really do the things that he's good at, right? But from what I understand, you're like, okay, this is the Navi approach, this is the Blade approach, and if he can adapt and work in this, then it's good. But eventually, if he couldn't and if it didn't work, it would just be okay, then Aleksib needs to go and we need to find another, you know, IGL that can fit the system. Is this kind of the approach that you had?
I think it could happen only because we had a talk from the beginning that, yeah, it was from the beginning, it was a risky move because we asked a lot of organizations, I mean, where he was playing before, because it was also a red flag for us, like why it's happening. So we wanted to analyze why. And but still, I liked a lot the NAP in the last 6 months when there was Aleksib. Okay, so this Paris major, I saw that dynamic and it was very positive. So that's I liked a lot. I think this was the main factor for me to approach Aleksib. And but yeah, we from the beginning said that I understood what is going on, and I said to Aleksib, bro, we need to understand this. Like, just go with our system as much as possible. Try to implement yourself inside there. Like, you know, like try to be in the system day by day, because otherwise it can be a problem. And like you said, I think we would be disappointed with the IGL and maybe changing him only in this scenario if he will be like super stubborn and just constantly doing like, no, we do this, no, I didn't want, like, not coherent, like not trying to cooperate, basically, right? This is only if he's trying, and I see this positive dynamic, for me it's fine, right? Mm-hmm. And that's why it's good now, I think. And about actually, I think Sponge asked about the idea of players to have the moves. I think, yeah, it's very important to have the moves on the map. But maybe it's weird comparison. If we compare like football and Counter-Strike, or maybe some other team game from sport, but just analyze like on players playing on the field in soccer, right? They are, nobody's IGLing them. They just know what to do, right?
Intuitively making the decisions.
Yeah, it's still different games, I know, but there is still in the deep inside, like in the roots, there's like still the idea of synergy, of understanding the game and making moves. And when he's doing this move, I do this move. And like something like this, there's always a strategy, always a game plan, basically. But still, I think it's important, at least like maybe 60-70% of the game, that people can play on the flow properly inside the system, not like YOLO running around the map. No, it's just you speak about game plan, you have the system, and they can play with the gaps, with the moves. There's no way you can do a faster decision from one side of the map faster than the, for example, electronic on the other side of the map. There's no way how you can. And maybe he has in the millisecond, he has already a plan, not even an info. And how you can change his plan, how it's possible. Like you only block his plan, and now it's a disaster. And also important part for yourself as IGL, I think it's very crucial, because I had this problem in flip side. I was also controlling a lot, you know, and it's really hard to play your game.
Yeah,
a lot of times
it's really hard.
So if you're focusing and you're part of the player, like doing the same thing as other players, you can also deliver more damage as a player on the map. You can be have more awareness, crosshair placement, and even dictating something. Meanwhile, you are not IGLing.
I was going to ask about, you know, at the beginning of the creation of this international roster, I think it was always obvious from the beginning that Aleksib had a big say in the players, or at least that, you know, you were building this roster together. So with that in mind, you know, if it hadn't worked out with Aleksib, you know, was it a really big gamble, you know, in that aspect, you know, that you took kind of a chance on Aleksib and built the lineup that you guys wanted together with him, you know, with the risk that it might not have worked out if he wasn't able to adapt to your system?
Can you ask repeat but differently a little bit, because maybe I don't understand.
No, I was just asking about how important was it for him to make it work, to adapt to the system, considering he also had a say in building the roster at the beginning of it, you know, when you were moving international.
I think for him it was, I think he said it somewhere in an interview, it was very, he took it as a chance, a huge chance to change something. And he was always building by himself, and now he will say, okay, why not? Let's try. I will just try to be part of the system. And he said that he fully committed in this aspect.
How would you then, I mean, you've been talking about the system and all that stuff. How would you kind of, in the most simple way, describe your philosophy?
Give us all balance, your secrets.
Not necessarily the secret, but maybe the balance between, you know, we've been talking about it a little bit, but the balance between how much, you know, the individual players have their own freedom and how much of it does come down to the game plan, the in-game leader, you know, and what their vision of the game is.
That's hard to put it in a short words, you know, and short amount of words, and at the same time not to expose something, really. I know, but for me sometimes to answer the question like specifically and describing by myself, because it's a huge amount of information basically, because you need to build it like not in one day, even like you're building day by day. If you put whole information like inside in 1 week, people can blow like up, you know, the head, how it's possible. So you need like layer by layer, like adding a lot of stuff in the system. But I don't know, it's mostly about the vision, how you see Counter-Strike, I think. I cannot say this, I think.
Okay.
I want to get into the conversation so Prof can ask about Emma.
For example, I see a lot of times a lot of coaches and players saying a lot of stuff like in interviews or some podcasts, I don't know. And I think sometimes they're saying too much. You can see the weakness or how he sees. If you know how he sees, if he knows these details, okay, then... then you can see from one example, you can see a scale, basically, how he see the horizon overall, you know? So I think it's important for not to say too much sometimes, because we're still a competitive scene, and it's actually very competitive nowadays.
That was actually going to be the
we're
question
gonna, we're gonna
I wanted to springboard
censor
to.
This. We're going to censor this from the VOD so people don't give us shitty answers. But the thing is, like, you, Blade, you actually talk a lot and you do say interesting things, but you still think, like, you keep your cards close to your chest. I mean, I think there's a balance between... Great, driving a motorcycle.
Sorry, everybody.
There's a balance between, like, not saying anything and being like, we played our own game, and then, like, giving away crucial details. Talking about that, Dastan doesn't want to do any interviews because he says he's going to say everything. And then James is going to kick him from the team. You know, he's going to give away all of the secrets. But it is kind of like that. You need to know what you can do.
Yes. Actually, I'm always having this under control. Whenever I'm saying something, it's always, I have it, like, I'm consciously saying specific amount of information.
The opposite of me. I wanted to pivot because I know Prof wants to talk about Emma, but I think that we can almost sandwich these next two things together. And you just said that you think it's very competitive. I was going to ask you how strong you think the scene is currently, like in this snapshot of Counter-Strike right now, how strong do you think the scene is?
I think it's very strong, and also important part that I think it must be obvious that with every months, let's say, this will grow. And if, for example, I think in Australis era, the Counter-Strike was lower. It must be obvious because this is the evolution process. As soon as there is a team with like every player gaining new experience, new knowledge, he is becoming like more complete. Then we added one more player, like we have more complete lineup, more complete players. Then like more games, more official like analysis from official games, and then every team building more knowledge and maybe building more system. Every coach does this also, right? And then they compete on tournaments. They basically play like round by round with more complex Counter-Strike, with more more complex Counter-Strike, basically more deeper in details, okay? And now take in consideration that a lot of organizations are popping, like new organizations want to go inside now. And for example, take Liquid and Astralis, these lineups, they have pretty strong lineups. They were not at the major. What does it say to you? The scene is very competitive, right?
Yeah, people say that they're unlucky, but realistically, those kinds of lineups a few years ago would like walk through any major qualifier, like regardless of their form or anything, just based on how good the players are.
Yeah, and also speaking about Astralis, for example, also example of people from different background where they need to find some, like, in middle of something. And for sure, like, MVP now with electroNic can be much stronger. Like, Spirit is not, for example, on EPL, which I was surprised I didn't know about this.
Yeah.
So, FaZe just won a tournament where there was no Vitality, Spirit, also maybe us. It's very also important, right? So, I think it will get bigger and bigger. The downgrade comes when one team is just disappearing, like just disband. This is bad, right? But this is like also natural process. And the peak will be where like where we find a moment where less teams disband, right?
Sure.
The moment when they're not still in the game, still
everyone's building.
Then when they're still like hungry for games, for wins, and trying to build something, when they didn't like give up and disband or lose players. This is the moment where the scene will be super competitive. I think this, everyone said the playoff bracket was how to say, like...
Stacked.
Stacked, yeah.
Very stacked, yeah.
But, okay, so this isn't like a gotcha.
Yeah, go for
this it. This is where I want to go next, because there's a lot of conversation about like people saying it was a fluke major win, and there's like negative comments around the victory of the major. Do you read any of that? What do you think about that?
I don't know. As I said before, the main question must be different angle. We must ask FaZe why they lose a major. Not like, is it a fluke? It's one question. Another question, why you lose with this lineup, right? Why you have like four star players who was like MVP like constantly, and like he was in the grand final seven, how much time in a row, and then you just fuck up Vitov, in my opinion, and then you're losing. And for me, Counter-Strike is not about... I think it's a little bit different, you know? I think it's about a moment. Yes, if you want to be to build a legacy, it's a different angle. Different angle. And speaking about this, yes, at this moment, they are like... we are not the favorites for this. Let's say like this. But at the same time, if you see the picture of our achievements of players, player achievements before the final, it's also very interesting, because it's not like we played 10 years and now we have a last dance and this is a fluke. We are just in the middle of the building something, and then major winning a major like is a huge bonus for us, you know. So for some people it's a fluke. But I think it's more complex thing. It's more like a lot of things connected to this. And winning a major is about a moment. You must, if you're picking at the right moment, it also must be valuable, no? I think, like, who is, if you dominate, like, the best team in the world, like, what was the score, 13-3 on the last map? How it can be a fluke? I think it's something, but not a fluke. Maybe it's not a super like stable thing. I don't know how to put it, but the idea is like it's not something huge, but for sure it's not a fluke, you know? How you can win FaZe, certain three in the last map? Where is FaZe then, right? So I think better to see on this angle that we had something in the last map that popped up and we can use it in future. And this lineup is very young and inexperienced. And they can use it in future as a boost of confidence, boost of knowledge, everything. And in this aspect, in this angle, if it is it fluke or no, doesn't matter anymore for me.
Okay. I think mainly what people refer to, mainly what people refer to when they call it a fluke is they think that it's not replicable, right? They think that NAVI, like let's say they think that NAVI is not going to win any tournaments and for the rest of the season, you know, for something like that, they will just think, okay, this was just them like one time occurrence, you know, for NAVI to have this peak. So I'm curious about what you think about that. If what you saw at the major is something that you think is replicable.
Okay, if we're thinking, speaking about the result, if we can repeat it, it's another thing. But overall, just to nail it, I think that winning a major can never be a fluke. I want to say like this. I don't think that Gambit won with a fluke. I don't think that Virtus Pro won with a fluke. Outsiders, I mean, or Cloud9. I don't think it was a fluke. You know. I don't think it's possible. It's all about the pressure. This is Counter-Strike. It's all about the pressure in the grand final. It's all about how you as a player and as a team will deal with the pressure, with decision-making, with a game plan, who was better in veto, who was better in game plan. This is a lot of aspects that connect to each other. So you cannot just do like say with one statement, this is fluke. You need to analyze deeper what happened and here and there. But speaking about result, if you can repeat, yes, it's interesting. And I think that we was, for example, in grand final of EPL with s1mple before.
Yep.
So it was kind of for us a good result because we like were doing steps, doing steps, and it was like a logical step for us, like because we did bootcamp one, well, then another bootcamp, and then after second bootcamp, Instagram final. And something from our point of view, we are going like in the right direction now. We were speaking about the peaking on major like in January or even in December, because if you see the dynamic in our calendar, this is, so for example, you see from November till December or from November to January, then in January you understand that how in dynamic it goes, right? Then we said that on major, this is the perfect timing because this is when the team will not be burned out yet. This is a team will peak in terms of, they will be peak of their knowledge, let's say like this, peak of the form. We can build more knowledge and we'll be another team, but with specific player, specific knowledge as a team, it was a peak for us, okay? And we are now doing right steps. And about if you speak about winning tournaments, we showed already that we can win. You can win any opponent. I already said this. You can win any opponent if you have a proper approach and specific matchup, specific match day, right? And I think any team is what they want. They want to win, right? We as a team wants to win. It's not like we won manager and now we just want to retire. Obviously, we are also building something. And I think that if we will keep grinding properly, like keep working really hard, I think we still have a huge chance to win tournaments. Because okay, like see, like what? Let's watch our results. In Katowice, we lost the complexity for playoff. I think right, match. It was we could win this match. Like we were losing 5-2 or something. On Blast,
Falcons.
Okay. So what was complexity? Something else? Maybe. It was before. Never mind. It was Blast in fall finals. Yeah. With versus Falcons, it was an engine, and I think we won first map pretty easy, and then it was engine where we played really good city side, and then we fucked up. We won pistol on T side and fucked up anti force, and then they just nailed us after that, if I'm correct.
Yeah,
but I mean we had a really good chance to go to the playoffs with that less experience. And then it was really good, I think, Blast run, right? And then we nailed, like, Aramars. and then the major. So speaking about dynamic, I think it's where everything going good now. And we spoke that before that the scene is very competitive. Okay. So do you think that FaZe will win like all events till summer? Like, I mean, EPL, Dallas and London? No, I think they can win zero. Also, it's possible. There's a huge possibility they win zero.
Yeah, of course. And
so I think for us, winning at least one of this event will be a very good result. If we just if you speak about the formula that FaZe can win zero, right? If FaZe can win zero and we can win one, isn't this huge?
That's good. Yeah, that's pretty good.
So I think that okay. it's very important to understand that we want to win tournaments, and I think we can because we already show this. Will we repeat it? I cannot guarantee this. Like, of course, but we for sure have a chance to do this for sure, and because we didn't show our potential yet. I think Mihai didn't show his potential yet as a player, and this is it's for sure different topic, but.
Can I ask actually about Ime? Because that's we had a discussion here after you guys won, obviously, about like Ime, his performance, but you guys still winning. And I think there's only two things that can happen. It's either you guys have completely redefined how to play these roles that he's in, and like him posting like a 0-9 rating is fine, or you managed to win despite him underperforming, right? Obviously, he provided something to the team. If he didn't talk or didn't do anything, you probably wouldn't have won the major, right? But do you agree that he did underperform this major? Like, this is not a level that is satisfactory for his role, right?
You know, he's actually doing a lot of roles that he was doing before. In Gamer Legion, for example, like he's going nuke outside on T side. He is playing like overpass our T side, also like on A. I don't remember like all from Gamer Legion, but I think also Mirage. Maybe he's still in middle, but changed a little bit. Most like I think 70 or 80% Ancient. He was playing mid city side, and now he's still playing on T side. I think he was also playing mid.
Yeah,
I think so, but I'm not sure.
But what I wanted to say is like not that you changed his roles, but like his performance in these roles is not what you would expect, right? What most people would say, he's like star rifler of the team. He's supposed to post, you know, 1.10 rating for Navi to have a chance to win a major, right? But he didn't do that. Yet you won a major, so it's hard to wrap our heads around it from an outside point of view. Is like, are you satisfied with what he provided, or is it like he needs to do better in the future?
I'm satisfied because we won, but at the same time, if we speak like about perfection, of course he could do better, and I think he understands that he can do better. But I would rather not compare his rating in Gamer Legion at all, because they have a different system, I think, not like ours. I think so, because I don't know theirs, but I think ours more complicated. And it means that for him, it's much harder to play. That's the thing.
Is there a team that you would compare your approach to at the moment in the top? Like, is there a team that you think is similar to the way Navi play the game?
You know, when we're analyzing a lot of opponents, maybe another team sees the same. You sometimes see that they don't do what you already speak that you must do, you know?
Mm-hmm.
So they're like skipping some steps, important things, or like not having the specific protocols for something. Well, maybe because they have another vision for this. So it's like different angles, different approaches. I cannot actually compare because I was not in the team. Maybe I noticed that Cloud9 actually was playing not fully like NAVI lineup, not fully, but I think they were doing a lot of stuff that we did before. Okay.
That makes sense, doesn't it?
Yeah.
Lots of your old players.
Yeah. And Boomage, like for him, is also comfortable to IGL, but I think they have a lot of new stuff for sure. But I'm just saying that, like, I saw a lot of stuff that we're doing, like old school, like from NAVI 21, and about other teams, maybe phase. I think from every team you can benefit. You know, like if you see the benefits from different aspects. The main problem you don't know how it's like
working behind the scenes. Yeah. Yes, you only see the results.
You can see some smart moves, and you just give it as example, guys. Look, what a really nice smart move. But FaZe playing really good Counter Strike. That's true. FaZe.
So the reason I ask is kind of the Prof's point or dancing around it in a way, because I was asking, and if you picked a team that you're like, oh yeah, these guys play similar to us, but if we picked other teams that play like good Counter Strike, we use FaZe, players playing the same type of roles as what Immer does would traditionally have more output as far as stats are concerned. But like, do you give a fuck about that as long as he's doing his job, like as long as he's getting the information, getting the space, getting that one key kill?
I think that Mihai is not, it's far from what he can be on this role. So important part on bootcamp, Mihai was completely different than he was on LAN. I mean, not completely different, but let's say like this, he was having a lot of crucial rounds when he could like change game changer rounds, you know, on bootcamp, but it is practice, you know, and on official, it's just important to find this balance. So he had much less these kind of rounds. In terms of success, he had a lot of important moves and very useful moves, very effective moves. But comparing like to the scale, like on bootcamp, it was sometimes really huge things. And that's the thing. I think it's all about finding the comfort zone on official match on LAN. And for me, as I say, a lot of times, don't forget, he is doing a specific goal. Like he must reach some goal for the system. Like, for example, he must do like map some little details to have a reaction on the map, or like maybe he needs to create a situation on the map. I don't know. And maybe he will die because of this, you know. And at the moment, he is not focusing on statistics at all. And this is what I like a lot. So no matter what is happening, he is fully in the round, what he must do in the round. Like, I must create space, I will create space. And we will use the space. And at the moment, we are not a complete team at all. So I didn't want to criticize, that people will criticize him. We are not a complete team at all at the moment. We are still building. Still building, and I see a lot of gaps at the moment in our game. It means that I can see that how we can fix them, and I see that we can be much better as a team. That's my point.
Okay. I had a question. You know, we spoke, I think, about half a year ago. This was like a month after you went through the change from simple to wonderful. And I asked you about, you know, how the atmosphere has changed inside the team, and, you know, simple being obviously a character that will put a lot of pressure on his teammates, you know, if he's seeing mistakes and stuff like that. And you said at the time that we would see, you know, how the team would be able to perform without that sort of pressure, you know, and if that would be better for the team, you know, moving forward. How do you see this topic today, you know, about after half a year, after having a bit more experience with the team, how they're dealing with the lack of pressure, if they're performing better because of it, or how does it change?
It's the same. I think that Mihai playing really bad under this kind of pressure. That's for sure. It doesn't matter how he plays now. It's more about like the mood in the team. This is actually connected to the topic we brought before about cultural like background. You know, it's completely different. Like, because in CS, it was before, it was like differing like characters, completely different mentality. And this is for me was first of all a challenge, and for second it was something we need to adapt for sure, like, and to understand what is the strengths and weakness of this. And for example, I noticed that it's really hard sometimes to say something straightforward for players, but it's important. Without truth is essential. Without truth, you will be sometimes can be delusional, or like some things will be not brought up, you know, like keep ruining
unresolved,
your
yeah.
It can be like a virus, like ruining everything in your head. Like you can be hesitant or like thinking, overthinking. It's important, like, to say sometimes something straightforward. And people sometimes, like I noticed, just can say like, you know, like maybe we can do this, like, and when there is like a real like bad situation, just need to say straightforward, like, this, we are fucked up, like, it's a disaster, like, why are you doing this? And this is, I mean, think for me, it's the correct way, because you were just facing the real problems, you're just trying to fix these real problems. And this is was also part of adaptation for us, like, that we are trying to build. And we must understand, we pro gamers, like, players are not somebody who was trained from the beginning, like in terms of
how to take feedback, for example.
Yeah, it's like you're not in sport like from 6 years when you are when people can criticize you constantly, like, what the fuck are you doing, like be like this, like move more, and like more like, you know, this approach of I don't know how to, maybe you know better the word, like when you are more persistent or trying to push to the limit the player, not with like gentle things, you know. And this is, I think, important in competitive sphere, let's say like this. And for sure, this was a problem from the beginning, because we were winning tournaments by saying things a lot of time straightforward. And we just get used to this. With simple, and he was sometimes angry. He could say that why he's angry, right? And people just understand. Okay, this is a different angle. I mean, kinda you serve this differently. You can serve it, you know, maybe you can do this, or you can say it straightforward, right? With emotions, and sometimes it's hard for you to keep, because you are not ready for this. If you, for example, beat, he was playing like this more than a year at least, right? And he is already, that's how we brought about the stage. You just see the stage before the playoffs. And the same is here. When you face it first time on LAN, it can be a problem. It can be a problem for your, how your body will react, how your brain will react, everything. Maybe you're just not ready for this. And I think this, how you said about the pressure. Now there's for sure less pressure for players. And for this lineup, we needed less pressure.
Okay.
That now, answers the question for sure, yeah.
Now, we've gone quite a long time into this hot seat, Prof. It's almost 9:30. How would you like to proceed,
Prof? That's a great question. I feel like we can kind of wrap up here, kind of. Right, obviously, we didn't talk about so many things.
Yes, people, there's a lot of things still to talk about, but yeah.
But what can we do? Honestly, like, I don't really care about IM Chengdu, to be honest.
No,
like,
me either. We can talk about it later.
Yeah, but like, even if we wrap up here in like 10, 15 minutes, and then we can just talk about like VP and FURIA without Blade and finish it off. Or with Blade, if he feels like staying, up to you.
We got to do the Skinionaire, right, as well?
This is true.
Okay, so let's do this. Blade, there's one question that I think people, you know, that everybody wants to talk about s1mple. So we'll get it from your mouth. What do you think is happening with the future of s1mple?
Actually, it's a mystery.
Can we solve this mystery?
Mm.
It's a mystery for you, or it's a mystery for everybody else?
I think it's hard because when you're not how, like, it's like Zhong Zhuang or something, you know, in chess. Like, you like already cannot do any moves because it's Zhong Zhuang, I think, or something. Because
fail knight, you mean?
Yeah, I mean, like, something like you need, if people want to take him in the team, they need to know that he's in a good shape. So he needs to play Counter-Strike for sure, constantly, and to. They must be maybe sure about this. Of course, it's simple. You don't need to test this or something. But if you are going into the season, you must have take time for this, right? Build roster around him and give this roster a time. At least give time to Simple. He's a great player and he needs time to get into shape again. Also, his CS2, which he was hating a lot from the beginning. So it's also about how he sees his own development at the moment from this point. What he wants to build, like in what role. I didn't speak about this with him before. A lot of aspects here, you know. But yeah. Who can pick? I mean, it's for example, look, we were trying to build a roster after Paris Major, and obviously we wanted to get some star players, and we couldn't. So what I'm trying to say is that you are sometimes it's hard nowadays to find a window where you can catch somebody who is under contract. Meanwhile, it's like two options. Either he is joining some team or some organization and building a roster behind him, right? Or in some scenario, like he's coming back to Navi, right? At some point in future.
Okay. All right. We got to wait and see what happens. Hopefully that answers the questions for the people at home who want to know about Simple. Now, look, Blake, we're going to do a quiz. Who wants to be a Skinionaire? We're going to do 5 questions. They're multiple choice. You get 60 seconds to answer each question. And every question you get right, it moves this slider up a notch. And if you get 5 from 5, one lucky winner in Twitch chat gets a $50 skin voucher. Are you ready to take on the task?
Yeah, maybe.
All right. Well, we'll find out. Did Dimitri do these, Prof?
Yeah.
Okay, so I assume, I'm going to hope they're Navi themed. Let's find out, all right?
There are some tricky ones, but fun ones as well.
Okay, all right. Well, look, people in chat, type trader, that's your raffle ticket to enter the draw, and we'll get this one underway ASAP. Trader.gg, who wants to be a Skinionaire? Question number
problem
one.
Problem is, I see bad quality.
I can read it to you. It's all right. It's okay. All good. Which team does Blade coach, the Spanish Blade? Movistar Riders, Navi Junior, or no team?
Which team he's playing?
Coaching.
And I need to answer this.
Yes. You can look. You can ask Striker as a lifeline if you want. He can help you out.
I think he's no team now, right?
That's correct.
Yeah. Okay.
All right. We'll lock in C, no team. Dimitri gave a tricky question as the first question. All right. Well, fair enough. Okay. That's funny. You guys have the same name. I like what Dimitri did there. You know, look at that. The links. All right. Question number two.
Mm-hmm.
What number will you get if you multiply all digits in nicknames of the current Navi CS roster? 0, 1, or 3.
What number will you get if you multiply all digits in nicknames?
Yeah, nicknames of the current Navi CS roster.
Well, coach count?
Oh, I don't. Ooh. I'm going to go with
Yeah.
Oh, okay. All right.
Let's just say it doesn't matter.
No, it doesn't count for sure because it's only players for sure.
Yeah, it wouldn't work so if it was coach.
Only one.
So one?
There's another one. There's another
0.
Player.
Wonderful 0, but still, yes.
Yeah.
Answer is 1. Because if me, it can be 5 or something.
But 0 times...
Multiply.
Yeah, it's not added. So it...
multiplied. Oh.
That's all right.
Damn, this is...
I don't know why they're telling you like this, Blade. I'm so sorry.
Already failed.
I'm going to fire the guy that did the questions.
That was... such a dirty, dirty
in
question.
In the middle, I think I opened the link that Lucas sent me, and I was a little bit confused.
We're getting sandbagged. We're getting sandbagged out here. It's all good. All right, question number three. Which of these majors Blade didn't take part in, neither as a coach nor as a player? Which of these majors Blade didn't take part in, neither as a coach nor as a player? ES1 Cologne 2014, E-League Major 2018, or IEM Katowice 2019?
Damn, maybe Katowice? There was Katowice 2029?
Okay, yep, Katowice. 2019 was...
2019.
Yeah, that was Astralis winning. And Aleksib in the final, right?
Yeah, I wasn't
was
there.
Was that Love Gambit?
I wasn't
was
there. It? Yeah.
Are you all locked in?
Yeah.
That is after Love Gambit, right?
Yes, I was in Gambit and then... Yeah.
Then you joined the NAVI after that,
and esports coach, yeah, Samsung.
Okay, nice. All right, well, we got two out of the three, right? Let's get into question number four. Which of the following...
Which of the following players didn't play for Flipside?
Yeah.
Was it Flamey, Simple, and Seized?
But wait. Seized was playing for Flipside for sure.
Oh, dear.
Flamey wasn't playing.
And Simple definitely was playing.
Yeah.
Yes.
Oh, what? What's going on here? This can't
be wrong. This is wrong, 100%.
All right, we'll blame Lucas for that one.
So
Lucas.
Flamey was playing for that team, I think. And then when we lost him, we actually got a Flipside organization. It's the same moment when they were leaving.
And he went to Hellraisers?
Yes, and Flipside were expecting us to have this lineup, imagine.
You know
we're saying, okay, we are ready, but we are losing two players. Imagine.
How so crazy to think that the player that stood in for Simple in his time and Flipside was Davkost. Davkost's still going now, mate. He's still trying.
There was a lot of things in Counter-Strike. I mean, if you just bring it up for a lot of teams, there were so many things, you know.
Mm.
Davkost is actually the Davkost, and there was a guy, Top Gun, right? Or something.
You mean Australia?
Yeah.
Yeah.
One time we were playing like versus maybe you actually.
Yeah. I got it right here.
It's
I got the game black.
In Katowice.
Yeah.
When we were playing like in a corner, you know, like this. Is this weird? Like
Yeah.
So here is Top Gun and there is Vault Edit here.
Yes.
Imagine.
Yeah.
Just imagine how we play like this.
Crazy times back in that gym.
And when we just lose around, like Top Gun is just turning around to Vault Edit and just saying like and he Vault Edit was like very scared because this is a big guy, you know.
Top Gun was huge.
He's
I mean
a big man.
Yeah.
Oh shit. We got one more question here. All right, question number five. Which Ukrainian coach besides Blade came the furthest at the majors in CSGO/CS2? Jonta, Kane, or LMBT? Ooh.
Obviously, Kane, he won the major.
Yeah.
Well, there you go. It wasn't that difficult. We left the easiest question to last.
Always unpredictable questions.
Yeah. Bloody hell, what a roller coaster ride that was. All right. Well, four out of the five, that ain't too bad. And a fucking maths question. I'm banning maths questions. I think they're banned from now on. All right, let's see who the winner is. Luke is going to put it in the chat. Oh, fuck, I can't read that. Sextender. Either way, congratulations. Our people will reach out to your people and we'll hook you up with the $15 voucher thanks to trade.gg. All right, well, that's done. That was the quiz. That was a bit of fun. We're going to run some ads. Blade, do you want to hang around? We're going to talk about VP and Fury after this, or you can leave. It's up to you. You can do whatever you want.
Yeah, I'm locked in, I think.
All right, nice.
Okay, there you go.
Let's run an ad break. We'll come back. We'll do some recent news.
Are you tired of your boring old skins? Head to Trade It and trade them for exciting new ones within seconds. With 24/7 support, massive inventory, free giveaways, and low fees, Trade It is the highest rated trading platform in the market. What are you waiting for? Start trading today for a $5 bonus only on Trade It.
Shoot it. one thing remains the same: victories with 1x bet.
Worth cooking? Yeah.
I think you've been influenced by your little Padawans in the team, like using the young lingo. Everyone's cooking.
You know, a lot of times I'm trying to explain something in the game, and by listening what we are usually speaking in the real life, we were trying to use keywords for a lot of stuff, you know, and it eventually appears that cooking is a very good word for a lot of things that we want to say. I want to say, like, what we're cooking, like, especially in our system now, this word actually have a huge, we have a cooking stage, just imagine.
Oh, okay.
In the game, cooking stage.
So that's like a default, or what was that?
Like, guys, like, it's cooking stage. What the fuck are you doing? Like, something, you know? Is this protocols are different in cooking stage?
All right.
This is good.
Have to keep our eyes out for that. All right. Well, we're just going to jump into a couple of recent news topics. And one of the big ones that happened Monday, was it Monday? I think it was Monday, was electroNic going to VP, which is where kind of blew the Counter-Strike world away. It wasn't leaked. There wasn't any information coming out about it. Did you hear anything behind the scenes, Blade, that this was going to happen before it was announced?
You know, I know that I think Bit not new, but I didn't.
Bit was on the inside.
I think so, but yeah, it was very secret information. I think because of the organization, maybe because it connects to Russia, you know. Mm. Maybe they are like the same, like very like secret and like separated from the world a little bit.
That's why they could keep it on the down low. All right. Well, this change, right? electroNic to VP in place of Mia. What do you think of it, Blade? Do you think this is a good move?
I think that for me, electroNic, like one of the best players in Counter-Strike, for sure. So there is no question about this. As a player, he is much better than Mir.
So good for VP, but is it good for electroNic? Do you think you should have stayed with Cloud9?
It's hard to say because we don't know what was going on in there, right? Why he left, why he decided to change the team. I don't respect the thing that he changed the flag back to Russia, because basically it doesn't matter, meaning if you support war or doesn't support the war. It's all about, like, during the war, you support the Russian flag. And this is, for me, I know that, like, a lot of analysts and experts try to say that this doesn't connect at all, but for me, it connects, actually. Because at some point, you will go with Russian flag, and Russia is doing terrible things now. They're just basically destroying, like, my country, you know? And there must be a reaction on this. I know people are afraid to express their opinions, but at least you can stop, like, how to say, like, popularizing the Russian flag, the country, because at this moment, this is not appropriate at all. This is an important part for me. Hmm. And overall, also, it's, I think, part of this aspect that he goes to this kind of organizations that connects a lot to Russian government. And this is something that behind the curtains, people, like, officially it's not like this, but behind the curtains is like one thing, but we know how it works around corruption stuff. And as a matter of fact, virtus pro players are still connected a lot to Russian Federation. This is for sure. This has a whole organization. Even if CEO is from Armenia on the stuff, if you see where they do, like, their, like, parties, all this stuff, it's still like in Russia, you know. And this is a terrible story, for sure, which we must remember.
Yeah, just for context for people that may be watching or don't know. I mean, this whole, like, flag thing with electroNic and Perfecto is like when they were NAVI, I think when they were NAVI, flags, right? They put on Liquipedia, they asked for a neutral flag. As far as I know, no one ever asked for it to be changed on HLTV. So it hasn't been. But yeah, they just had like a white flag or a gray flag or whatever on Liquipedia for the longest time. And then electroNic changed sometime last week. I think people said something about
it. There was a thread on Reddit about it, yeah.
Yeah, so it changed very recently, and then this move to VP happened. And yeah, as Blaze said, they have like, there was this change of ownership.
For me, it's
a
weird coincidence.
Like this, but
it's
yeah,
weird coincidence.
I also didn't think anything about it until, you know, now when the VP move came in, then it kind of adds a bit more oil to the fire.
But right? Yeah, speaking about overall the game, it's also about style. So Yusponge asked about how it's good for him, but it's completely different styles in Counter-Strike, like what he had in Navi, in Cloud9, and what is VP doing as a team.
Do you think he fits over there? They play very...
Wow. I don't know what word you'd use to describe
it. I saw people were saying like something like Yekindar with Jayne was a good combo, but I also want to think, but because I don't know. Did they win like some big events?
No, I just think Yekindar looked very threatening in that team, didn't he? That was why probably because when Yekindar kind of was really great at making entries. But he was the only one taking a lot of space for the team, if I remember rightly.
But that's why also a lot of the time you could just see that whatever he did was kind of, it didn't matter, you know, because he was so far ahead of the rest of the team that, okay, he did something on his own.
Space, yeah.
Sometimes he did win the rounds by himself because he just got a couple of entries into a site and then they just got free entry, right? But usually it was just like he gets an entry, he gets traded, and the rest of the team plays for another minute for the round, you know? So I'm not, like, I don't know what to think about that.
It's good for electroNic that they have a lot of young players. I think he can teach them a lot of things, like this Fame, Fleet. It's players that I think they actually sometimes playing even face it together, but still, like, this is important for like fresh blood, fresh, like very hungry players. It's good for electroNic to have this, and at the same time, he can teach them a lot, I think. About style, this is again the same story as for any other team. It depends how everything will be organized. I don't know how Dastan is like coaching, how he's, what is his approach and so on, how much of a role he has here, like, because the rumor is just, it's also mostly about Jayne, you know, and the style, what VP was playing by now, before Lieutenant came, for me, it's much easier than playing versus FaZe, for example, you know.
Okay. I know some teams have a hard time playing against it. They don't like playing against that style, but for you, you think it's an easier style to play against?
Much easier than FaZe, for sure. Okay. So versus VP, you always kind of... it's not like they can surprise you. They're not surprising the opponent a lot of... Not often, they're surprising an opponent in the game, you know? It's a lot of... 90% of the game is expected things happening on the map. So you are kind of anticipating them. The pace is very slow, and you can work around this. It's like the pace is different. That's the thing.
Okay. Prof, if I was going to throw this your direction, right, we know electroNic has had a bit of the fire in his belly. He played with s1mple for years. We see he did some in-game leading with Blade. He used to get quite fired up. It felt like when he was in-game leading, he would be very vocal for that short period of time. Do you think, looking at some of the track record of players that have played with Jayne, Chiron seemed like he was vocal. I don't know, but he was a rookie essentially. Yeah. Yekindar, I'm sure, had a bit of lip about him. electroNic, though, is a major winner. Right? How do you see this kind of all working? Do you think it'll help diversify the way they play?
I think so. I think otherwise it doesn't make a lot of sense. Like, why would you bring a player like this if you don't want to work off of his qualities? And his qualities aren't just, you know, killing people on the server, for sure. I think that, but my fear is, if you look at Jayne and like VP's track record, they have had so many aggressive players actually on the team that have just over time turned into not aggressive players. And if you go back to like, even when they had like Buster, Kicker, Adren, these are actually all aggressive players, but they are turned by Jayne's system into like so giga slow players. And then they add Yekindar, then they add like Flit, then whoever comes, like the other guys just take a back seat. And I think that's what I'm scared of here, is like, then how this influenced like Flit, for example, how Flit fit into the system. Like Fame has already been demoted into like a kind of an anchor as well on this lineup. So there is going to be kind of a reshuffle of importance and responsibility on the lineup for sure. But I honestly think it will make them better. I do think it will make them better. And if it doesn't, then well, you kind of, I don't know what to say. I don't know what to say if like signing electroNic makes you worse. Like it doesn't make any sense. Then you really are kind of fucked up and limited in your approach to Counter-Strike, right? But I think this is the other side of this is like, if Jame can't win titles with this lineup, then all of this hype of Jame is kind of fake, right? It's kind of like he's just a guy that can do pretty good with under like below average pieces, but then when the pieces are actually good, then he can't do it, right? He needs to win titles with electroNic. This is like, by the end of the year, he needs at least like one trophy.
Okay.
You know what is very spicy is the thing that where there were a lot of shuffles usually, and a lot of times analysts, experts, talent experts were kind of like already making a calls, you know, like this lineup will be like crazy, this one will be, it's important part that on paper it's one thing.
Like Cloud9 last year is a good example of that. They should have been nuts.
I think Astralis lineup was meant to be like really good. I mean, with Blamef. Sure. What was the reaction in community? That's my point. Like Cloud9, I think this was the main like.
I think that was the biggest flop in terms of expectation to what it was in the last 5 years.
Yes, and for me, it's also like as I said, on paper, it's one thing. But in real life, it's important, like how they will connect to each other in the game, what they will build, like in terms of like their system, kinda, right? And the same is here. Yes, electroNic on paper must improve 100%. He must improve, like you said. But what if again? I don't know. It's different thing can happen. Ego sometimes can be a problem, you know. If everything will go smooth, yes, that's okay. But the same has happened, for example, with other rosters. Like, why Astralis didn't work the lineup? Oh, they removed Blamef. Now the lineup is Cloud9. Didn't work. Shiro banished himself for some reason. Now electroNic going out for some reason.
Something's not working.
So this is still... Okay, not red flag, but yellow flag. Something like something going on there, right?
But I think you can also compare these lineups and say, like, I think for Astralis, at least the three of us here were very skeptical just because of the roles that didn't really make a lot of sense. I think for Cloud9, all of the roles made a lot of sense, except the IGL did not really make, not that it didn't make sense, but we saw that after a few months, electroNic like gave up on IGLing, right? So that means that the IGL role wasn't covered as much as we thought it would be. And I mean, even you were hyping up electroNic so much.
We won
events
with electroNic as IGL. Mm-hmm. We won event. Yeah, and it was Lisbon. Last Lisbon, we smashed Vitality in the final. I still think that electroNic. So it's important part. Okay, so there is like let's say skill or like. Possibilities of a player to fit the role, right? And trust me, electroNic has everything to be an IGL. Everything. He has a huge macro control in his head. He has a very good decision making, very good analysis. So it's all about circumstances, because obviously he doesn't want this role. It's very like bad role, you know. He can be a star player, a tough role, yeah. And in
he
our
said
lineup,
to me that he was too emotional for it.
Yes,
perhaps.
Yes. Actually, this is what I was thinking about also today about IGLs. That sometimes, because you're taking everything under control, you want to be everything perfect. This is a habit a lot of times that I had a story about this, like you said, a lot of times before from different players. That one player is trying to take a lead, and then nothing works, and he starts to be super emotional and super kind of angry on everyone. And now the mood is different, and everything is different. And it's not a one-time story, you know. It's maybe a habit or a burden of IGL, let's say like this. But yeah, electroNic is should be okay. I think let's say like this. He and Jane must find a good connection. That's the key to success.
Okay. All right. Let's jump to our next bit of news. FURIA making changes. Gary and Art out. They're actually looking for an international coach. I saw Blade. Do you want to go coach the Brazilians?
People were actually tweeting when we posted, like, you're coming on the confirmed. The first three comments on Twitter were Brazilians asking you to come to FURIA. So I guess
actually,
the offer's there.
There's these guys from Brazilian fan base, like, who is common casters. Mm. They're always like very positive, very nice. They like NAVI.
Dallas guys, right?
Yeah, they're really nice guys, actually. But actually, Rio is very nice place, you know, and I remember the ocean, amazing. Ocean was amazing. But yeah, it's interesting changes. Everyone said it's better later than never. That's true. And Casey Serato in a jail, like we used to say.
You did that content piece about Casey Serato being in jail.
Oh yeah.
I think every Taiwan team at some point wanted to take to buy out Casey Serato, and every team failed. Was the same answer was there, like no chance. And this is an interesting team actually, because at least we can start from that Casey Serato was not didn't want by himself to leave the team at any time, I think. So from this, you can also start to understand what is there, like, as a inner kitchen, like we used to say this word. Like, what is going on? Like, what's the cooking there, kind of? And it's all going behind this. They're like, this stuff. And at some point, we all know that Casey Serato and Yuri was great, very, like, really good players at some point. And when they was in the prime, and I think they were at some point better than now, right? And I'm not saying they're done, but still. At that point, they needed a good change, like to execute these players at the highest level, because these kind of players can do a lot of stuff.
Vlad, I'm going to ask you a question, and I understand you're probably going to say it's about how they work in jail, but I want to throw the question your way anyway and see what you say. Do you think FURIA can succeed having Fallen just take over the in-game leader duties, or do you think they should try and get somebody who was hot at the last major, like Big Uzera from Pain?
First of all, I'm very confused because I lost the track. Who is IGL there? Because
join the club.
Because I still think that Fallen was always IGLing, no?
No.
Not always, no.
Who was IGLing at the major? Like, I was confused.
I think it was Art.
But now I read that Fallen will continue IGLing.
That's my point. I think Fallen was doing this from the beginning. I think so. I think from what I understand, like, you know, reading between the lines, is they put him in the team and he instantly started to dictate something and they wanted to a smooth change. So Art was helping a little bit first tournaments. Then Fallen was IGLing. And then till the end, he was IGLing, and Art was just a second caller. And from what I understood, maybe it's wrong.
I'm pretty sure there was a point where they stated that Art took back over. Like, I'm almost 100% sure.
I'm actually trying to look.
But I don't know if he was in-game leading at the major or not.
No, note said he was IGLing 100%. I'm pretty sure we did an interview with him where
so
he
Art
confirmed this.
So Art will be on HLTV Confirmed next week.
I mean, he already had his own little stream where he said a lot of things.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, he said a lot of stuff. It was actually quite interesting. Like, they wouldn't let him drink and all this stuff, and why Henny left and everything like that.
Yes, I missed that, so I don't know.
Blade, did you ever try to convert your players to veganism, for example?
Don't do that, bro.
Wow.
Apparently,
like, by force, if by decision, if they want to decide what you're offering and they say, let's try, it's one thing. But if it's like a must think, it's a different story, for sure.
No, I think they kind of mentioned that, and it was like a fun thing that everyone caught on to. But I think it was more like, I think it's more like what you explained is like, hey guys, try this out. You know,
have you ever tried this Brazilian
barbecue
meat?
Yeah,
festa, or how we call it? I don't know. I tried it once. I was really
hard
confused.
To be a vegan after that. Yeah.
They bring you meat like every 5 minutes. I don't know.
Oh yeah. That's
I know.
The
it's like
it's not a barbecue.
Yeah.
That's why they want at some point to be vegan. Maybe, I don't know. It's too much meat.
In a meat coma. But okay. So do you think they should? Because regardless of who was in game leading, do you still think Fallen can and they can succeed?
Well, I think IGL role. How request or how like it demands from you a lot of experience and knowledge. This is must think, in my opinion. And we know there are some young AGLs. They're not that bad. They're good. For example, like Xans, Yuhi, they're really young in terms of experience. But still, I think that Carrigan is for a reason as a good AGL now because he has a lot of experience. And that's why I think Fallen can be a good AGL. And I'm not a huge fan of OPers IGL like Cadian, Jam, and Fallen. Do you know any others, actually?
Device?
The club. Welcome to the club. So it can be interesting, but still, he knows how to do this. That's my point. It's the only thing he must understand, if now modern Counter-Strike allows us to do the same level, the same way as he did it before. And so Fallen is a great player for me still. I think he can be a good at any role, an IGL for sure, better than even maybe than Biguzer, I don't know. Okay, it depends on how they piece the puzzle, piece everything, you know? Mm. Who will they take in the team? Is it really the same everything or no? Change art?
At the moment, it's just art, and they're having one of their academy players standing in. That's the thing. Like, it really depends on how deep the changes run. Because
yes.
Like, I agree with what you said about Yuri. I think Yuri can still be a good player. Kayserot is a very good player. Cello, I think, is an aggressive piece. If he's used differently, I think he can be good for the team. So I don't know. I think it's a positive sign for FURIA to make some changes. I think there's a lot of good Brazilian players who they could get. Like, you've got Insani from MIBR. He's really good. Like, there's a lot of good names out there.
And FURIA actually didn't play bad, right? I think they didn't achieve anything, but they were not losing like 13-4, 13-4. That's my point.
No? But the way they were losing
13-11 to LinVision and these teams, but then they came back,
Came back with some event recently in China when FURIA came back on Nuke.
In China, would that?
I don't
been,
think in China. They won an event in Finland.
Espo, you mean?
Won an event in Finland. Yeah, that was not bad. But then they also came back at the major. They started very bad, and then they came back, got the
second stage. Yeah.
Okay, so I didn't watch make deep analysis of how they play. I think we even didn't meet versus this kind of lineup on an official match.
Yeah,
I think so.
Approach was a bit... Yeah, sorry, Shaka, go for it.
No, Marsh. I was just going to say, in line with what Prof was saying somewhere earlier, what did you expect, when you put Fallen as the in-game leader in a system that Art and Gary have created and keep them both at the same time? I think it is a good sign that both of them are now not going to be, at least not hands-on as, a coach and in-game leader. I think that's a good... At least that's a way for Fallen to truly take over, without... this weird clash of playstyles that they were talking about for the entire time that this lineup was existing. So I think that's a good sign moving forward. It depends.
The question is where we want to put FURIA. Like, you want them to be top five Well, you wanted them to be top five with this lineup, for example, right?
Well, I feel like a Brazilian team with all the talent available should definitely be like a solid top 10 team. Top five, okay. You know.
Top 10
yeah,
is
making
acceptable.
Making playoffs like more consistently. Yeah. I think that's okay.
Or being
where
close
they should
to
be.
Anyway.
Yeah, but like
they were at the beginning of their tenure, right? I mean, they were like post COVID, even they made all the three major playoffs. They were still in a pretty okay place.
Yeah, this is
but
like
it's just going downhill. Yeah.
And recently now it's like, will they make it past the play-ins? That's kind of a realistic question for FURIA. It has been for like quite a while now. So that's not great for what is supposed to be the best Brazilian team, right? And there is, as you say, Chad, a lot of talent.
Yes,
but
the best Brazilian for sure. I'm just saying, if even the best, where can be the world? Like top 10, I think good. Top 5, it's not possible, in my opinion, at this moment.
Yeah. Yeah, it would take some time. But the question...
It's more about the depth of the pool, right? Like if you brand yourself as the best Brazilian team, like you should always get the best talent, at least on paper, right? But that's not necessarily happening. They haven't really changed so much.
But I also think it's like you're supposed to, as a team, like what Blaze is talking about a lot, is like you're supposed to build, you know, you have a system, then you replace some pieces, you build on the system, blah, blah.
But now they start again.
I think they nuke the system, so...
Yeah.
Then the only reason why you want to join FURIA is A, salary, or B, good players. And they have Que Serato, which is a key thing. So like most Brazilians will want to play with Fallen and Que Serato, but they don't really have anything good going for them. They are kind of starting from scratch. So
But it's still better
time.
Than anything else in Brazil. So it's surely like there's motivation. Yeah. It's more about the contracts and stuff.
Yeah. But I wanted to ask you, Striker, we didn't talk about this at all, but I think it's before we end, we need to talk about this because everybody asking, what about Cloud9?
What's going on with Cloud9?
Why aren't they getting Monacy? What's happening? You said they're not getting
I feel like, this is about my tweet, huh? I think like some people even misconstrued that tweet. They thought I was referring to like G2's results like in recent times for the reason why Monacy wouldn't leave and blah blah blah. No, I mean we've heard from G2 repeatedly that they're not gonna get rid of Monacy.
He's not for sale.
And yeah, exactly. He's not for sale. They've said that a million times. And you can say, like, of course, an organization would say that about their star player, but like, come on, they would be crazy to let him go if they don't have to, and they clearly don't have to. Falcons tried and they couldn't get it. Like, that should tell you something, you know? Falcons try for Monacy and they couldn't get him. That should tell you something about the situation in G2 and how much, you know, how much who's being jailed or whatever. Like, of course, Monacy also had a motivation to stay because he liked playing with Nico. I think there was a lot of truth to that. But obviously, a lot of teams have been trying for Monacy and haven't been successful. So, like, what does that tell you? Like, he's just not going to leave anytime soon.
I think for me, it's like, okay, maybe they got a lot of cash from selling electronics, so that could be, you know, an extra factor to get Monacy. But like, I don't understand now, if electronic leaves,
why are you joining
Cloud9, right? That's kind of, for me, the problem, because yes, you have Boomich, who has been good at IGLing, and you have Perfecto, who's great in his role, but I don't think out of the Hobbit Exile combination there's not much going on, I feel like, that you would leave a team. Of course, if you're a free agent or something, okay, maybe, you know, G2 is completely failing, then you want to jump to Cloud9. But I don't see what the appeal is right now.
Monacy to VP, electronic IGL.
Yeah.
I was considering that, you know, like I was...
They didn't say they're gonna make big moves. So,
yeah,
you know.
I spoke to the VP CEO, did a long interview with him, and when he said that the part about, you know, that they have the highest ambitions, and they were like, he was big on sending a message to all the star players who are not available at the moment about how much VP mean business and how much they want to get players. I'm like, you know, a lot of people have been asking around for Monacy, and I think there was a rumor that VP wanted Shiro, and that would be with James, so James would probably transition to rifling,
oh,
you know?
Hell.
So they wanted Shiro when Shiro was benched himself on Cloud9. That didn't happen. At least that was like some rumors going behind the scenes. I can't say I can confirm it, but that's what was going around, you know. So maybe you're onto something.
I think he lost in answers. I don't think there was an option for this.
What do you mean?
How Jem can be a rifle?
Yeah, it doesn't make sense, huh? That'd be crazy. Imagine him saving an AK every round instead of an
so he mode. Will be a Sanji or something?
Imagine Jabe transitioning to be a Sanji. That would be crazy.
Dropping arms to someone what else.
Poor Sanji, man. Blade, I want to ask you one question before we wind it down this evening, because we've been going for over 2 hours, so I don't want to hold you for any longer. I want to ask you this. Who's the best Counter-Strike 2 player in the world right now?
You know, it's a very, very interesting thing, because it's from which angle, like you,
your angle
to look,
Blade's angle.
Because everyone is saying like Donk is like super crazy mechanically, right? But he doesn't have an experience, and decision making is for sure different. Like he's fully on the flow now. It's usually it's like by feeling a lot, you know, not by calculating like with his experience and knowledge. And that's why it doesn't usually last long on a stable basis, you know. You need some system behind your decision making for sure. And if you speak about this, I mean, like for sure Monacy and Donk, like everyone is saying, showed the best results individually now. That's for sure. Like Monacy Oper, Donk is a rifler, right? But if you ask like experienced players, like you sometimes Cardigan, he says like Rain is very underrated player, right? Mm-hmm. So sometimes this is even more important. You don't need like the best player in the world. Maybe for system you need a guy who will execute the role that you see perfectly. That's the main thing, and that's how you must see this, all this stuff. But if speaking about like from viewers' point of view, for sure, like this is players with highest ratings right now, like Monacy and Donk, I think.
Okay.
But speaking about players, yeah, I think I really like how Monacy is playing now. That's for sure. Like he is, and I'm not the first one who's saying this, he's like on a different level of creating situations on the map, like what he's doing on the map, basically. But yeah, overall, we still know that people are cooking, you know, like Vitality, Astralis, even Liquid, and FaZe, obviously. And I think all this team has a lot of star players. And all the star players can be activated at some point, right?
Mm.
So, for example, at some point, like I think Twist Z can do like amazing things on the map. You speak about FaZe, like Crops, the way how he moves on the map, how he thinks, how he tries to outplay like on micro level or like a lurking, it's also another level. And me like admiring a lot how he do moves on the map sometimes. But we saw like before playoffs, so I think he has a better results, right?
Mm.
So you see how it works. Like it's very situational, you know. But if you can see the knowledge and how the player think, or the way how he shoots and like how good is he mechanics, it's two different aspects.
Sure. Okay.
So your answer is Monacy. I wrote this down.
Okay. Yeah, Monacy. I think at the moment, yeah, for sure.
Okay. Nice.
But it's not a huge gap between him and others. I think maybe. Zaivu is still a great player, and if he activates himself at some point, he can be the same level as Monacy. That's my point. But for some reason, he doesn't on under pressure on big stages, and with all these flames, you know, like around him, that he doesn't play, doesn't win Katowice, Cologne, all this stuff, and it gives a lot of pressure to him still.
Okay. All right. Interesting. All right. Blade, we're going to shut the show down for the evening. Is there anything that you want to say to the viewers at home? Anything you didn't get off your chest? It's been fantastic having you. We've got a lot out of you. We could have gone for hours more, but I think we better close it down for tonight.
Yes. Thank you, guys. Thank you like for having me. Thank you, everyone who's watching this. Thank you, like NAVI fans, that you support us. I liked a lot of the conversation, like the knowledge that we were like sharing here to each other, and angles, different angles. It was very interesting conversation. I think you're doing important things, the same as others. I think all people who are now like doing like content in terms of getting like deep knowledge from players, from coaches, considering like all others, like broadcasts, with Torin, with Janko, with Maui, and all this. I think all this content is very important nowadays. So shout out to all you guys.
Well, Blade, yeah. Pro League starts next week. If you want to come join us when you guys are there, you can come jump on the couch, have a chat. We could do more of this live if you're interested, if you're not too focused on winning. You know, we'll see if you got time.
Okay, guys.
All right. Wonderful. Well, thank you very much. Thanks to everybody watching at home. And we'll go back with another episode, hopefully before Pro League. We'll work it out. Thanks to OneXBet. Thanks to Trader.gg. Thanks to everybody tuning in. Thanks to Blade. Good night.
Good night.
Are you tired of your boring old skins? Head to Trade It and trade them for exciting new ones within seconds. With 24/7 support, massive inventory, free giveaways, and low fees, Trade It is the highest rated trading platform in the market. What are you waiting for? Start trading today for a $5 bonus only on Trade It.
Thing remains the same. Victories with 1xBet.